It's really great to be here together with all of you. And I hope you've all been inspired by the last 2 days like I've been. I think it's always, it's kind of like being plugged into the internet directly when you come to this kind of event. And while I look forward to a day of actually that being for real, this is about the closest we can get to it today. I know how precious all of your time is too, so I really appreciate you spending that time with us. And I also want to thank all of you, many of you, for your business and your partnerships with us. We really appreciate that and look forward to many fine years of that. Now, I also want to thank Chip from Lululemon, who presented earlier for this sweatshirt I'm wearing, which I really like. Just wanted to give that quick ad also. Now, when I was 12 or so, my parents actually gave me an autobiography of Tesla. And when I say Tesla, maybe some of you think of the rock band, maybe you think of the electric car company now, but actually it refers to Nikola Tesla, which was, when I was 12, I guess that was probably the main choice. And I thought I wanted to be an inventor when I grew up. And I was sort of, brought up with computers. I was really lucky to get my first computer when I was 6, because my dad was a computer science professor. That was in 1978, so pretty unusual thing to do. I thought I wanted to be an inventor, and I read this book, and this was like the greatest inventor you could imagine. I mean, he was kind of an evil mad scientist. He made lightning bolts, and he made the things that we use for electric power now. We still use Tesla designs, basically, to generate and distribute our electric power. And once I finished reading this story of his life, I basically cried at the end. Because I realized, you could be this world's greatest inventor, and you could basically be a failure, right? You could have trouble funding your inventions. Tesla was actually working hard on transmitting power across continents wirelessly, and it's still not known exactly what he had in mind. And it might be if he was better able to fund his research, we would actually have that today. That's not that unlikely, probably. So I kind of vowed, well, what do you actually do about this? Well, you actually need to invent things, and you need to get them to people. You really need to commercialize those inventions, and obviously the best way we've come up with doing that is through companies. And so I figured, eventually, I want to invent things and get them to people and get them to use them and to benefit the world that way. And that's kind of been my goal since. And I think our goals for Google, if you understand it in that context, make more sense. That's actually our goal for Google. It's super simple. We want to build technology that everybody loves using and that really affects everyone. We really want to create beautiful, intuitive, services, technologies that are so incredibly useful for people, so incredibly useful that people use them, twice a day, like you might use a toothbrush, right? And there aren't that many things you use twice a day. It's actually pretty hard to come up with something like that. Now, we actually just roughly hit our 13th birthday at Google, and I think we're running a doodle now or something. It's always a little bit of a debate exactly when our birthday is. We didn't really start paying ourselves or start working. It's a little bit amorphous, but we're roughly there, and it's been a while. And I think that, looking back on what's been successful, well, what have we done that's really worked well? Having a user focus and also iterating really fast have really been determined what was successful. Now, I like, in thinking back about search, why did we start doing search? We were doing some research at Stanford we thought might be interesting, and we actually were talking to all the people in the industry, who were doing different kinds of search, and we said, if you type, we had done some interesting research about ranking things better, and we had typed in, university, into the search engines at the time. And it was amazing, when you type that, you basically got random web pages. You got pages that said university twice in the title. And we said, we went to the people who made these search engines, said, why are you doing that? Why would I want a page? And they said, well, this is user error, right? You shouldn't have typed university. And we're like, What? I can't possibly be wrong, I'm just a user, right? And they didn't quite understand that, and that's how we went on to build a search engine, because we realized nobody was focused on that. Now, I think, you know, that's true for still very many areas in the world. There's still, sorry, let me get a drink. I still see a lot of areas where people don't have that user focus. And I think it's true for most of computing right now. I was remarking to somebody here earlier, you know, if you look back, you know, you took a programmer from 30 years ago, maybe Eric can tell us. And, you know, you transplanted them today, I think they would roughly know what's going on. Like, it's not so different than it was then. In fact, we still use some of Eric's code. It's so good. So look, let me talk about the user experience in terms of Google+. Obviously, we're super excited about Google+. You know, it's, I think, you know, really understanding people better, understanding what you want, personalizing that is very, very important. And we want to build a closer relationship with all of our users, with all of you guys. And we want to integrate all of our products so they're easier to use, more intuitive, and we want to make sharing on the web happen like real life, right? You know, if you're at this conference, you say different things than if you're, you know, in your family or you're with your coworkers or whatever. And that's what circles are, and we're really excited about that. Now, we also wanted to have an amazing experience for mobile. You know, use actually your phone, probably more than you use your computer now. And that trend is only increasing. And, you know, one of the things we did, which is amazing, is when you take a picture with Google+, it automatically gets uploaded. And then you can, you know, in seconds, you can share it, decide who you want to share it with. And it's just a totally magical experience. Like, you don't have to worry about anything. It just happens. Now, also, Will.i.am, who's here, recently did a Hangout with us, which we're really excited about. And this is a serendipitous interaction where you basically just, you know, enter a video conference, but with people all around the world, and you can have a great conversation with them. And he did this recently. He's going to do it again Friday, 6 p.m. Eastern time. He's running a concert, which will be really exciting. But we're looking forward to that. Now, this, you know, search is also very important to us, obviously. So when you do search, we really want you to be able to have a great experience. And for that, you know, knowing what other people like, what they're plus wanting, what things people are sharing is super important. And you can already see that happening in search. And we're really excited about that. If you do a search on Google, someone's plus oned it, you'll see it right in your search results. And that's a big, big deal. I'm really pleased with Google Plus so far. It's been a, you know, the team has been doing an amazing job. It's really on fire. I'd love for all of you to sign up. I think you got an opportunity to do that, but love for you to do that and see Will's concert on Friday and participate and really help us build that future as a community. I'm really excited about that. So let me just switch gears for a second and talk a little bit about really talking about how you choose what to do. And one thing I've noticed is that if you're super ambitious, actually it's often easier. And you know, that sounds kind of counterintuitive, but if you have a healthy disregard for the impossible, you actually get better people to work on your project. You know, they get really excited, they work really hard, you know, they work late at night. And it also turns out that most companies aren't crazy enough to do anything like that. And so you don't really know, nobody else is doing it, so you're the only ones. And again, you get the best people. Now, you know, we try to do a lot of things like that, and I'll just give you some examples from the past. You know, when we bought Android, it was a small company. It was 2005 when we bought it. And they had a dream that they were going to use an open source operating system for phones to really standardize an industry and make things really productive. I mean, that was a crazy goal, right? It was something like 20 people at the time. And you know, I had a whole industry. We had a whole closet full of phones that all didn't work. Something like 100 phones we had in a closet, and we had to write software for each individual one. But having that ambitious dream and a long-term focus, they were really able to succeed. And obviously, Android's the largest shipping smartphone operating system now. That did take 6 years, right? Now, I feel like, you know, in thinking about this, I see the same movie playing out again and again. You know, people thought that Android was crazy at the time. They also think that many of the businesses we're doing now is crazy now. And in fact, you know, I look at things like Chrome, people say, oh, why do you need another browser? You know, there's plenty of browsers. You know, we've got 160 million people using Chrome, and it's growing like crazy. And it's how you access the internet. That's an important thing, right? And display advertising. You know, people said, oh, there's all these big providers of display advertising. You know, what are you guys going to do? Now we're a huge provider of display advertising. And I'm really excited about that because it's growing like crazy also. But it's also really funding all the content that's on the internet. That's an important thing, is to fund that content that gets created and to do it better, to do it with a better user experience, to make the ads more relevant to people and more useful to people. And we're really applying the science of what we did with search advertising to display advertising. It's working great. And it's not that surprising, but you know, if you watched Ray Kurzweil's talk earlier, you know, people get confused that, you know, when you have something that's growing quickly, you know, you think it's small, and then the next day, basically, it's huge. And that's what I've seen with all these businesses. YouTube, which Mark some reason thinks we shouldn't have bought. I disagree. I think it was a great acquisition. You know, we have over 3 billion playbacks a day there, and that's growing like crazy also. And we've multiplied our ad revenue by 3x for 2 years in a row, which has been amazing too. And that's it's a huge business. It's going to be a much bigger business. So what's the takeaway from this? I think if you have a well-run technology business and it has a lot of usage, you generally make a lot of money. Over the long term, if you take a long-term view. And that's how we've operated our company. And I think related to that, you know, if you look at short-term and long-term change, it's very, and this is a well-known kind of research fact, people tend to overestimate the next year what's going to happen. You know, you sort of see the trajectory, you see what's going to happen, and you assume that it's going to happen much faster than it actually does. But when you look at the next 5 years, you really underestimate that effect, especially of the exponential type growth systems that Ray was talking about. And I think that in technology, we're still very, very, very early stage. So we're way overestimating the next year, and we're way underestimating the next 5 years. And what we try to do is to make sure we're driving the next 5 years. And I think that's our job. Now, what are these things? Well, I think the tools that we use for interacting online are going to be completely different 5 years from now. You know, if you think five years ago, or 6, 7 years ago, we had no social network tools, really. You know, just things were completely different. And I think if you look 5 years from now, they're going to be completely different again. There's a lot of user interface issues with what we're doing. There's a lot of potential to make people's lives better, to make things more efficient, to make things more enjoyable for people. And we're trying hard to build those tools as Google+, and we're super excited about that. I also thought I'd mention mobile briefly. You know, it's not that long since we've had a phone in our pocket, right? And a phone is really a computer. It's connected to the internet. It's actually as good as your desktop computer was 3 or 4 years ago already. And knows where you are, it's always with you. And those capabilities are just going to completely change the world, and we're very, very early on in that, too. We just launched last week mobile payments, our wallet product. And you can use an Android phone without a wallet, use our wallet, And you can buy something, and it's an amazing experience. You just tap, and you can pay for it. Your phone keeps track of it. It's secure. It's an amazing experience. And that's just the tip of the iceberg of these kind of applications for phones. Now I'll just finish here and say that, you know, technology is really changing the world. You know, we all know that. It can really improve billions of people's lives. And that's what we're excited about. I think we at Google, we have tremendous responsibility to really carry that mission forward, to make the world better. That's why I'm here, why I love technology, and why I love my job here at Google. So thank you.